The first group of candidates from the College of Aviation is being led by Professor Emeritus Fred Cohn. Professor Cohn was selected by the graduating students as the student marshal for the College of Aviation. Professor Cohn will be carrying the gonfalon of that college. The gowns that you see here today are three in number and styling. That of the bachelor's degree is a yoked closed front garment with long pointed sleeves. That of the master's degrees has sleeves long and closed, but slit just above the wrist. The gown of the doctoral degree has full bell-shaped sleeves. Only the doctor's gown is trimmed with velvet panels down the front and three velvet bars on each sleeve, which represents the college of the university with a granted degree. As you see here is the College of Aviation. Followed by them will be leading the College of Engineering is Dr. David Lanning. Dr. Lanning was selected as a student marshal for the College of Engineering, and he will be carrying the gonfalon, the banner of that college. The cords that you see on some of our candidates were presented at our Honors Award Luncheon yesterday. Gold cords are worn by candidates graduating cum laude, a grade point average of 3.9 or higher. Red cords are worn by candidates graduating magnum cum laude, a grade point average of 3.70 to 3.89. And white cords are worn by those candidates graduating cum laude, a grade point average of 3.5 to 3.69. The International Honor Society for Computer and Electrical Engineers are identified by wearing orange cords. Mortarboard, a National Honor Society that recognizes college seniors for outstanding leadership, scholarship, and service, are wearing white and gold cords. And leading the candidates from the College of Arts and Sciences will be Mr. Rick Gibson. Professor Gibson was selected as student marshal for the College of Arts and Sciences and will be carrying the gonfalon for that college. Leading the candidates from our Masters of Science and Safety Science program is Dr. Max Fogelman. Professor Fogelman was selected by the graduating students as the student marshal for the Master of Science and Safety Science program. And then leading the candidates of the worldwide campus is Dr. Gary Witt. Dr. Witt is the Director of Academics for Embry-Riddle Worldwide, and Dr. Witt is carrying the gonfalon for the worldwide campus. Ladies and gentlemen, at this time, I ask that you please remain standing, remove your hats, cover your heart for the posting of Embry-Riddle's Air Force Detachment 028 Honor Guard for the posting of our colors. Color Guard, post colors. At this time, graduating senior in interdisciplinary studies, Mr. Andrew Wren from Frederick, Maryland, will perform the national anthem.
Oh, say can you see by the dawn's early light, what so proudly we hailed at the twilight's last gleaming, whose broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight, o'er the ramparts we watched, were so gallantly streaming, and the rocket's red glare, the bombs bursting in air, gave proof through the night that our flag was still there. Oh, say does that star-spangled banner yet wave o'er the land of the free and the home of the brave?
I'd ask that you please remain standing. At this time, Ms. Afton Brown, an aerospace engineering candidate and soon to be commissioned second lieutenant in the U.S. Air Force from Las Vegas, Nevada, will give the invocation.
In the words of our Heavenly Father, I urge you to live a life worthy of the calling you have received. Be completely humble and gentle. Be patient, bearing with another in love. Make every effort to keep unity of spirit throughout bonds of peace. Ephesians 4:1. Heavenly Father, please let us always remember your words that inspire us, your strength that supports us, and your love that guides us in all aspects of our lives. Lord, thank you for our gathering here today, for our present company, and for our absent friends. We humbly wish to thank you for your divine help throughout our academic careers, for the chance to grow, live, and learn with one another here over the past few years. We ask that you give us strength in any future endeavors, and that you may choose to challenge us, and that we pray that whatever path you lead us down, that you will bless and guide our journeys along the way. In the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, amen.
Let's continue to give a round of applause for Ms. Afton Brown and Mr. Andrew Wren. Audience, you may be seated. Graduates, you may be seated. What a special day. And before we begin, let me note our guests that are indeed that this is a time of celebration. And while we will be commemorating these events in pictures and video, we know that many of you want to take the time to take personal pictures of the ceremony. Please feel free to come forward and take that close-up picture of your special candidate on stage. But I do ask that when you come forward, that you make sure that you leave quietly and be as courteous as possible to others. And please do not impede the flow of our graduates. Please also note that in the back of your program, you will see that this complete ceremony and celebration is being photographed and videotaped. So if you miss that important shot while you're applauding your graduate, you will be able to get it later on. Thank you all for being here. At this time, I have the honor of introducing to you the members of our platform party, each of whom you have has a role in conducting the commencement exercise on our stage. First, I'd like to introduce our Executive Vice President for the Prescott, Arizona campus of Embry-Riddle, Dr. Frank Ayers. To the left of Dr. Ayers is a very special guest of the university, and today our commencement speaker, Secretary of State for the State of Arizona, Mr. Ken Bennett. On his left is the Chief Academic Officer for Embry-Riddle here on the Prescott campus, Dr. Richard Bloom. The faculty recommend candidates for degrees to the academic deans. The deans, in turn, recommend candidates to the Board of Trustees that the degrees must be then conferred. Representing our Board of Trustees for Embry-Riddle Aeronautical University and seated on Dr. Bloom's left is Dr. David Robertson. Mr. Robertson will officially confer the degrees. Next is Dr. Christina Frederick Recasino. She is the Vice President of Research and the Assistant to our University President, Dr. John P. Johnson. To her left is Dr. Archie Dickey, the Dean for the College of Arts and Sciences. Followed on his left by Dr. Cass Howell, Dean for the College of Aviation. And on his left, Dr. Chuck Cohn, representing the College of Engineering. And now it gives me great pleasure to introduce our Executive Vice President for the Prescott campus, Dr. Frank Ayers.
Well, good morning, graduates, or soon-to-be graduates, parents, family, friends, spouses, our faculty, our staff. This is a very special day for the Embrittle family. This is when the Embrittle family gathers together to honor those who have completed a rigorous course of study and are about to go out in the world and do what Embry-Riddle graduates do. And let me tell you what I think that is. Our graduates go into fields that involve the safety of the traveling public. They go into national security. They serve in our military. They're responsible for the integrity of the business processes of our nation. They make a difference. They are special people who go out and do things that have to be done correctly, that have to be done right, or there are consequences. And this great young group of people you see in front of you are those, the latest group, who's about to go out and do that. And we are very proud of them as a family. I would tell you that for the parents and the families, we would like to thank you for letting us participate, for giving us 4 or 5 years of your son or daughter's life where we might be a bit of an influence. Our faculty and staff really care about the young people that are sitting in front of us here today. We feel like they are a part of, that we share a responsibility with you. And we celebrate their achievement, hopefully just as much as you do. There'll be a few tears shed today. I've already seen a bunch on the part of faculty and staff because we've made friendships with people. We've helped them compete in flight team competitions. We've helped them through finals. Yes, we did write the finals they had to take. And some of those have really hard questions, don't they? Yes, yeah. But that's on purpose, because when we set high standards, people who achieve meet those standards. And as I said, they go out and make a difference. So today is a day of celebration on the Embry-Riddle campus for the Embry-Riddle family. We're excited about your future, but we're also a little sad to see you go. But we hope over time you'll stay connected with us. We want to know how you're doing. We want to know where you are. We'd like you to drop us that email to tell us that maybe something we did made a little bit of a difference in your life. So please, please stay in touch. And that goes for the parents and family as well. Please stay in touch with the Embry-Riddle family. Now, it is my pleasure to introduce our guest speaker today, and we are really privileged to have a friend of Embry-Riddle and a friend of the state of Arizona and an incredible public servant who's going to be with us today. Our speaker is Secretary of State of the state of Arizona, the Honorable Ken Bennett. He was selected by Governor Janice K. Brewer to replace her as Secretary of State and sworn into office on January 26, 2009. And an Arizona native, Secretary Bennett was born in Tucson and resides in Prescott, a hometown boy, as it were, with his wife, Jean Tenney Bennett, and they have 3 grown children, Ryan, Dana, and Cliff. He began his public service career right here in Prescott, serving on the city council in 1985. He was mayor pro tempore in 1988, and he served in the state senate from 1999 to 2007, and was president of the senate during his last 4 years in office. Now, he left office because of term limits. So he's an exceptional gentleman, and he left because he followed the law of the state. He was also chair of the Education Committee in the Senate and received the Polly Rosenbaum Award from the Arizona State Library Archives and Public Records in recognition of his unfailing support of the state library's mission to preserve Arizona's history and to provide access to information on the state. Prior to his career in the Senate, he served on the Arizona State Board of Education. And over dinner last night, we spent quite a bit of time talking about education, a subject that's near and dear to all our hearts. And he was president of that board from 1996 to 1998. You see a pattern here. He takes an interest, he becomes involved, he does the hard work, and then he leads. That's what Embry-Riddle students do, too. So we're very proud to have him here. Since leaving the Senate, he has been involved in energy issues and working to find sustainable solutions for the state, and then, of course, most recently was asked by the governor to serve as Secretary of State. So without further ado, I'd ask you to please help me warmly welcome a friend of Embry-Riddle, a friend of the state of Arizona, and a great public servant, the Secretary of State of the state of Arizona, the Honorable Ken Bennett.
As you can see, I brought some props today, and I'm going to try to keep this brief because I know you students are not here to listen to a long speech, and I know the families that are here are anxious to see each of you come up and receive your diplomas. I want to begin by just congratulating each one of you for being here today and making the dedication and sacrifice in so many ways and areas to be here today, and I want to congratulate as well, as did Dr. Ayers, all of the family members, friends, and loved ones who helped these people be here today. I'd like to just share maybe three or four thoughts with you today and try to keep it brief, but maybe share some things that I've observed in my life that might be meaningful as you contemplate your future. The first thing I'd like to talk about is, as you now look forward with a degree and a career probably in front of you and beginning to map out the things that you're going to do and the way your life is going to be, my first counsel, I guess, would be to expect the unexpected. When I was a little bit younger than most of you are, one summer day I was invited by my brother and a friend of his to help his friend's grandmother move. It was down in the Phoenix area, and we went down and helped her move, and they dropped us off at my grandparents' home, where we were supposed to meet up with our family. And they had just bought a nice, large lot home in South Phoenix, had an orchard in the backyard, pecan trees. And they dropped the three of us off. We were in our late teens, and we ran up to the front door and found it locked, but we had been told that they might be out shopping or doing whatever they were doing. So just go around the back. They'd leave the back door open and go and make yourselves at home, which we did. And my brother and his friend went in the front room and were watching TV. And I went in another room. I was listening to the stereo. And about 5 minutes later, I heard the screech of tires out in front of the home. And I kind of casually peeked up, looked out the front window, and saw a Phoenix police car had just parked kind of in front of the home. And there was a police officer running across the front yard towards 7th Street. Now, that part of South Phoenix at the time, the other side of 7th Street was a little rough. May still be. So I was sure that something was going down across the street. So I got up and headed quickly to the back door to see what was going on across the street. And as I got to the back door in a large hurry, in came a 6'6" Phoenix police officer. Helmet gear and everything, gun drawn, burst in the back door as I'm running to the back door. And he pointed the gun in my face and said, put your hands on your head, which it took me several seconds to find where that was. And then he proceeded to ask me several questions that I had either not a very good answer for or just couldn't answer at all. What are you doing here? I'm listening to the stereo. Is this your house? No. Whose is it? It's my grandmother's. And I'm sure he did not believe that because, you know, a teenager running to the back door. Anyway, he didn't believe it. Fortunately, Grandma had left a little note on the kitchen table that they were out shopping. And we showed that to the police officer. He had a buddy with him that was at the same time pointing a gun through the kitchen window at my brother who was on the telephone. And we were able, with Grandma's note, to prove that we were in the home okay, or by permission, and didn't get hauled off to jail. But that taught me to expect the unexpected. Speaking of graduation today, my father graduated from the University of Arizona years ago with a degree in agriculture, and he was working in his field of passion and endeavor for a couple of years, and then one Christmas morning when they were up here visiting in Prescott, got the call that the owner of the farm's son wanted the job that my dad had, and he was no longer employed, and he went from being an agriculture employee and passionate person about that to buying the family gasoline and diesel fuel business, and he went from agriculture to oil overnight. So expect the unexpected. Second, I'd like to talk about a little bit is balance, keeping balance in your lives. As you begin to go out and apply the things that you've learned and studied, you're going to find that there's all kinds of pressures on us. And maintaining balance in your life is very important. Now, I'm a very visual person, and I've brought a prop. This is a 3-iron, one of the hardest golf clubs to hit, but anyway. And I'm sure we have all tried to balance some long object on our hand. And you'll notice that when you try to balance an object, there's a couple things happening. First of all, even if the object itself is unbalanced, like this 3-iron is, and in our lives, not everything's going to be of equal importance and time spent. You're going to probably spend a lot of time in your careers and your vocations, maybe not get as much time to spend with family or your hobbies or whatever it be. But when you're balancing something that even has a little extra weight pointed in some direction, it's very important, two things. One, as the object begins to fall in any direction, in order to keep it balanced, you have to move in the direction of the weakness. You've got to move time or resources or something in the direction of where it's beginning to fall in order to keep it balanced. Another thing you learn is that if you wait too long in order to move, it's almost impossible to move fast enough to keep that balance. And the third thing that you learn is that it's almost impossible to balance an object by looking down here. In order to balance it, you got to keep your eye up here where you're going, not where you're at right now. So just remember that maybe, and I have to credit this little object lesson to a friend of mine here in town, Boyce Bryce, who shared that in a talk, and I've always liked that illustration. The third thing I'd like to share with you is the concept of hanging around with leaders. And to illustrate this concept, I'm going to show a little clip, a video, of probably the greatest upset victory in the history of the Olympics. Now, most of us remember the Winter Olympics of 1980 when the U.S. hockey team shocked the world and won the gold medal. But as far as track and field, if not the one of the greatest upset victories in the history of the Olympics, occurred in 1964 in Tokyo, Japan. In the 10,000-meter race, where an unknown runner, a Native American runner named Billy Mills from South Dakota, won the 10,000 meters. Now, the expected winner that year was a runner from Australia named Ron Clark. Clark had a unique technique of running. He would run one lap at the normal speed that everyone else was running, and then on every alternating lap, he would sprint. And over the course of his young career, he had become the world champion by using this technique, because on the sprint laps, very few, if any, could keep up with that. And in fact, in the final race of the 10,000 meters in Tokyo, sure enough, less than halfway through the race, because of this technique, Clark was on the lead lap with only 4 other runners. Now, Billy Mills was not an exceptional runner. The world record at the time was in the low 28-minute range. Mills had never run below 29 and a half minutes. And to make up a full minute in one race was just unthinkable. This is a sport where you might make a 5-second or 8 or 10 second improvement over your previous best, but not a full minute. In fact, Mills had come in second in the U.S. Olympic trials and had run a full minute slower than Clark in the preliminaries in Tokyo. But I want you to watch a clip that we're all going to be able to watch. I apologize. I downloaded it off of YouTube. It's not the best quality. But you'll see that by the time they get to the last lap, Ron Clark, the favorite, is now only accompanied by two runners on the final lap. The unexpected Billy Mills and then a runner named Gamoudi from Tunisia. Everyone else has fallen off the pace, and only the three runners are there. And you'll see that even though Mills is temporarily leading the race for a few seconds, Gamoudi actually pulls out to the lead. Clark is running second. Mills is beginning to drift back into a distant third, and looks like there's no way he's going to make it. And let's watch and see what happens in one of the greatest upsets in Olympic history. The last few seconds repeats here. You can see that he's almost out of the picture. But the key is, if you're running with the leaders and you're on the lead lap, you have a chance of doing something that you may never have thought possible if you're hanging around with the leaders and whatever you're doing. Thank you. And then I'm already, I think, over time, but I'm going to close with one final comment, and that is, it's all about people. Now, each of you may be receiving degrees in engineering or whatever it might be, business, and on and on and on. But I would remind us that it's all about people. Our family enjoyed a video that we saw and then bought because we liked it so much back in the early 90s when our kids were probably 10, 12, 14 years old. It was called Sneakers. It was with Robert Redford, Ben Kingsley, and it's about espionage and this device that they think is a answering machine. Turns out to be a decoder that can decode any computer system in the world and get through the security. And somewhere in the movie, Ben Kingsley says to Robert Redford, it's all about the information. Well, I want to say today that it's all about people. Dr. Ayers mentioned serving in the state senate. When I got elected to the state senate, my mother gave me two gifts. I think she was just really cleaning out her game closet, but it was a Trivial Pursuit game about the United States Constitution and a Trivial Pursuit game about the state of Arizona and some history and stuff. And I set them aside in my office thinking, what in the world am I going to do with trivia games? And then just 30 minutes before we went on the floor for the first time, it occurred to me that maybe in order to get to know my colleagues on the Senate, I was brand new, one of only three new senators of the 30, that maybe I could ask a trivia question each day and give out a little prize. So I ran down to the basement of the Senate and I bought this nice big Snickers bar. And I fumbled through all the cards in the Trivial Pursuit game and got one that I thought was a nice question and waded through the about hour of the floor sessions and all the things that happened. I was nervous, brand new freshman, didn't know how to make the motions right to ask for a point of order and all this. So finally, just as it was about to close, I raised my hand and blurted out and asked the president of the Senate if I could have a point of order and stumbled through all of that. And she was surprised. I hadn't checked with her to begin with. You always check beforehand. And I said I had a trivia question and I had a Snickers bar to any one of the senators who could answer the question correctly. So I asked the question and I was dumbfounded. 60 and 70-year-old senators, both men and women, were jumping over their desk, elbowing each other to get back to my desk to answer the trivia question first for a Snickers bar. And I learned two things. First of all, I learned that you can become almost anything if you give away enough chocolate. I attribute the 4 years of doing the trivia question every day on the floor of the Senate to how I became president of the Senate. But the other thing I learned is I wasn't the best lawmaker, and the best lawmaker didn't always become president of the Senate or in leadership positions. But what it did for me is it allowed me to build relationships with people. And influence, in my opinion, doesn't come from the size of your bank account or the number of degrees, with all due respect, that we might have. It really comes from relationships that you build with people. One of my heroes, and I'll close here, is a man I've never met. His name is Dick Hoyt. He's almost 70 years old, but about 30 years ago, he realized that his about 15-year-old son at the time, who had cerebral palsy, could not speak, could not walk, could not stand or run or anything. But they had found a device that Tufts University had created that allowed him to communicate. Dick discovered that his son Rick wanted to run in a race, a 5K race, for a disabled student in his middle school to raise money for this student. And even though Dick was not a runner, he decided he would run in the 5K, and they came up with a little chair that they could push Rick in, and he ran the 5K with Rick in front of him. And when they got back and finished, Rick communicated through his machine that when he was running, he didn't feel like he was disabled. And so for the next almost 30 years, Dick and Rick ran almost 1,000 long-distance races, including 12 triathlons, swimming, bicycling, running, hundreds of marathons, 25, I think, for the Boston Marathon alone, all the while pushing his son, who had cerebral palsy because he had been born with the umbilical cord wrapped around his neck and oxygen had been deprived to him while in the womb. I have a hard time talking about this story without getting emotional, because that's the way I was born. And my mother was told by the nurses and the doctors in the Tucson hospital that I would have severe brain damage. Now, some of my political opponents would probably say that came true, but anyway. But they told her that I would never speak, that I would never be able to communicate, that I would be a vegetable, as they told Rick's parents. And the family had a prayer and pleaded that that would not be the case, and why my situation was different than Rick's is immaterial. And in fact, I challenge each of you, if you get a few minutes this evening, go onto YouTube and just put in Team Hoyt, H-O-Y-T. That's what they refer to themselves. And you'll probably get to view a couple of videos that reinforces the concept that it's all about people. And today, as you look forward to the rest of your lives, even though you'll do great work in the fields that you have chosen, and you'll want to change the world, if you want to change the world, then make a positive difference in the life of another person every day, especially if they're younger than you or quite a bit older than you. And if you'll make a difference in the life of people, then you will change the world. Thank you.
Secretary Bennett, in the Amarillo family, there's a symbol for leadership, and that symbol is the Amarillo eagle. And one look at an eagle lets you understand that an eagle leads. We thank you for your leadership. We thank you for coming here today to share with us your experiences and your wise counsel. And we thank you overall for being a leader. Here you are, sir.
Oh, hold on, picture.
do a shake and hand. Yeah, we'll get over. There we go.
Great. Thank you, Pat. I'll get the rest of that for you. Okay.
I'd like to lighten things up for a minute, if I could. And I teach philosophy. And Ken Bennett was able to teach philosophy with a golf club. I found that very instructive, and I plan on emulating him in the near future. But because Embry-Riddle believes in teaching students up to the moment of graduation, if not after, I'd like to point out, if you ever have a husband who has an accident in front of the house at 2 in the morning, and you need to rescue him, you could use it for that purpose, too. So I thought I'd just share that with you. Thank you. Anyways, that was really a great speech. I'm sure we all appreciated it. But now it's your turn, graduating seniors, to provide a student speaker for equal time. And that's an Embry-Riddle tradition. In past years, student speakers have manifested brilliant erudition, wild humor, the height of the platonic sublime, Dadaism, hermeneutic and post-structural aporia, surrealistic and phantasmagoric mentation, and at times political banality bordering on subversive cognitive implosion. And you thought Embry-Riddle was just about flying airplanes. Well, what will this day bring? This day, the birthday of a popular musical legend. No, not Britney Spears. No, not Snoop Dogg. But Frank Sinatra himself, his 93rd birthday. He did it his way. And so did the class of 2009, who, in its infinite wisdom and august wisdom as well, has selected Ethan Grimsley, an aerospace engineering candidate from Hinckley, California, to represent them. Ethan, please come forward, and I'm sure you'll do it your way.
Okay, hopefully I can live up to maybe like a quarter of that. All right. Good morning, my fellow Embry-Riddle graduates, family, friends, and random people who enjoy graduations. This day marks the completion of many promises that we've made. Some of us made promises to ourselves, others to family members and friends. And some of us, let's not forget, made those promises, oh so many promises, to those hungry banks. So I know most of you think today is about the graduates receiving our degrees. But my mother disagrees. Let me explain it to you as she explained it to me. She said, Ethan, make sure you smile when you receive our degree. I, of course, asked her what she meant by our degree. She said, well, I raised you, I made you, and I helped you pay for it. So it's pretty much like I did it too. Well, I can't argue with that. So to all the parents, grandparents, other family members, and friends, just because we're the ones receiving the degree today, don't think you didn't earn it with us. For the engineers and computer sciences students in the group, this marks the end, well, at least a slight break, from the endless amount of equations and tests where we walked out hoping, no, praying, the all-important curve would save our souls again. The GSIS students, this marks the end of you guys believing you're the only ones who've used the library loan program to write a paper. Okay, that's probably true. For the pilots and controllers, this marks the end of the engineering comments of, what's it like to have free time? Or how does it feel to actually get A's? even though we all know we'd be in a tight spot if we had to pass a check ride. For the meteorology people, this marks the end of you having to go in that room in AC1 that everyone forgets about but has the really cool monitors. For the space physics people, this marks the end of your undergraduate degree, but you picked a degree where your college lifestyle is far from over, so you keep enjoying the ramen, and I'll be calling you doctor sooner than you think. And to the business graduates, oh, I was informed not to forget them. Remember, be nice to us when you're a boss. To the mysterious master's students, this is the end of you being sent to the far edge of campus, far, far away from the rest of us. And finally, to the ASP people, I hope you pick the right three minors for this economy. Although we may have different majors, we do have a lot in common. Embry-Riddle has been an experience that we really couldn't have had anywhere else. This is the only place I've ever been to where you can go to a party and a drunk person will come up to you and try to explain case hardening to you and ruin any movie that even remotely involves terrorism, science, or technology. The Riddle experience has been one where if an assignment is due at 7:45 a.m. on Tuesday morning, 80% of the class can be found in the library at midnight, and 30% of the class in the design lab after that. It is a place where most of us have wanted to give up at some point for whatever reason. In those times, we have found professors that encouraged us, and some that told us to consider other career opportunities. We made it through, though, and boy, doesn't it feel good. So to the professors, I say thank you. You guys really are what make us world class. This is a school where everyone, everyone has a technical degree. That is why I think you'll appreciate a realization I came to as I wrote the speech. Throughout our academic life, our instructors have used the next stage to scare us into doing better. In fifth grade, they told us the middle school teachers will not accept this level of work. In middle school, they told us the demands of high school would mean we need to step it up. And you can bet they scared us in high school about college. In college, they've continued this trend, but I'm here to tell you, the cycle stops here. No one's gonna let us scare us about the next stage after this one. No one's scaring us about retirement. For most people, when they leave high school, they go to college because it's what their teachers, parents, or society has told them to do. They go to college without a passion for it. Well, I can say with 100% confidence that every single person sitting in these seats has a desire to be here. The academic and financial pressures that Riddle puts on you make sure that you really want to be here. If you don't believe me, think back to freshman year. Where'd everybody else go? Even though we're in a time where most people in this crowd that have jobs have lieutenant in front of their name, I'm not worried. We'll make it through this too. If this were a movie, Eye of the Tiger would start playing after my speech, and we'd hip at the pavement passing out resumes and having interviews until that perfect job finally handed us a job offer. Well, call me an optimist, but I don't believe that's too far-fetched. Our time at Riddle has been different for all of us. Some of us worked for the university as RAs, CAMs, machinists, librarians, clerks, and other various things that probably had little to nothing to do with our major. Some of us joined sororities or fraternities, proud to be a SIG. And most of us joined clubs, or if we were really ambitious, we started a club. So what if it only lasted one semester? We did it. All that stuff is important to our experience here, but I think the most important thing is the friends we've made here. The school is wonderful that it's small enough that you'll get to know a large portion of this of the student population here. That is the most important non-academic thing that I take from here, the friends that I've made. I hope we don't immediately lose touch with each other as we leave here, because I've met some of the most interesting people I've ever met here. Well, I've talked for quite a while now, and I can appreciate all of you taking the time to listen to me, but I know most of you, if not all of you, are thinking about what comes before Part B. For those of you who are still asleep, that is Part A. So as we leave to celebrate and consume what is probably very unhealthy levels of adult beverages, And I leave you with this thought. Embry-Riddle has been an experience that changed and molded our lives. It has taught us so much academically and socially, and now they are handing us a key. This key opens many doors, and it is my supreme hope that we use this key, this tool, to achieve whatever future we truly desire. Thank you.
I have the tiger? I think not. Well, we have a world beyond Embry-Riddle, and I'd like to talk about that. Ladies and gentlemen, we live yet again in a time of war and great national challenge. Not just in Iraq and Afghanistan, not just a long war on terror, but in many locations, for many purposes throughout the world, wherein our great nation is being tested. And in this time, our nation is fortunate that Embry-Riddle Aeronautical University, with its history of Volunteers of America, with its history of heroes, is once again offering its best and brightest to meet and overcome the challenge, to sacrifice, even if necessary, to make the ultimate sacrifice for our country. Regardless of your position on the security issues of today, let us be thankful of the fact that we have turned out yet another cohort of the best of what humanity has to offer, with a call to duty, yes, a call to glory, something appreciated especially by all of you in the audience and on stage who have answered that call. I ask that you contemplate and introspect, that you let your prayers go with these men and women, our newest, greatest generation, who are to be entrusted with a commission in the United States Armed Forces. I first call upon Colonel Mark Haskins, Commander, Air Force ROTC Detachment 028, to conduct the U.S. Air Force commissioning ceremony.
Good morning. I'm honored today to have the opportunity to give the oath of office to our Air Force's newest second lieutenants. The oath of office you are about to hear is essentially the same oath taken by American officers since the early days of our first president, George Washington. Upon taking the oath, these young officers join a long line of dedicated and talented men and women who have gone before them, protecting our country's shores and national security interests abroad. Their watchwords, duty, honor, country, do not belong to West Point alone, but to everyone who serves in our military forces. Will the fall 2009 Air Force ROTC commissionees please raise your right hand? I state your full name. Having been appointed a second lieutenant in the United States Air Force,
having been appointed a second lieutenant in the United States Air Force,
do solemnly swear to support and defend the Constitution of the United States,
to support and defend the Constitution of the United States,
against all enemies, foreign and domestic,
against all enemies, foreign and domestic,
and that I will bear true faith and allegiance to the same, and that I take this obligation freely,
and that I take this obligation freely,
without mental reservation or purpose of evasion,
without mental reservation or purpose of evasion,
and that I will well and faithfully,
and that I will well and faithfully,
discharge the duties of the office,
discharge the duties of the office
upon which I am about to enter.
Upon which I am about to enter.
So help me God.
So help me God.
Ladies and gentlemen, the Air Force's newest second lieutenants. The Air Force ROTC Distinguished Graduate Program represents the top 10% Air Force ROTC graduates nationwide for the academic year. This distinction, the significance of this distinction is evidenced by the fact that this is the only honor accorded that they've earned during the Air Force ROTC career that actually remains within their Air Force permanent record. As I call your name, please stand forward. Lieutenant Peter Arnold. Lieutenant David Greco. Lieutenant Andrew Zeliff. These are your Fall 2009 Air Force ROTC Distinguished Graduates. Thank you.
I next call Lieutenant Colonel James Adams, officer in charge of U.S. Army Eagle Company, Lumberjack Battalion, who will conduct the U.S. Army commissioning ceremony.
Good morning. It is my distinct honor and privilege to issue the oath of office to the Army's three newest lieutenants. As they're moving forward to the stage, I would like to take just a second and recognize one young man who is seated amongst you, but in our hearts will be standing on this stage today. Mr. Kevin Jenkins, please stand. But for some unfortunate circumstances, Kevin would be up here today. Kevin, thank you for everything and good luck to you. Come on up. Raise your right hands and repeat after me. I state your full name.
I, Christopher Allen Thorne.
Having been appointed an officer.
Having been appointed an officer.
In the Army of the United States.
The Army of the United States.
In the grade of second lieutenant.
In the grade of second lieutenant.
Do solemnly swear.
Do solemnly swear.
That I will support and defend the Constitution of the United States.
That I will support and defend the Constitution of the United States.
Against all enemies, foreign and domestic.
Against all enemies, foreign and domestic.
And that I will bear true faith and allegiance to the same.
That I will bear true faith and allegiance to the same.
And that I take this obligation freely.
And that I take this obligation freely.
Without mental reservation.
Without mental reservation.
Or purpose of evasion.
Or purpose of evasion.
And that I will well and faithfully.
That I will well and faithfully.
Discharge the duties. Of the office upon which I am about to enter.
The office upon which I am about to enter.
So help me God.
So help me God.
Ladies and gentlemen, the Army's newest Army second lieutenants.
I finally called Colonel Fred Cohn, U.S. Marine Corps retired, and Prescott alumnus Captain Brian Beck, U.S. Marine Corps, to conduct the Marine commissioning ceremony.
What time? Hurt. Detail. head of the Navy and the United States Marine Corps takes great pride in offering a commission as a Lieutenant of Marines to candidate Matthew Trevino. Candidate Trevino, you've worked long and hard to get to this position. If you're ready to assume the responsibilities as a Lieutenant of Marines, indicate to me by taking one step forward. Very well. At this time, I'd like to ask all of the newly commissioned officers in the Army and Air Force to stand and face about to your family and friends. Also, everyone in the auditorium who has ever served in any branch of the armed services in any rank, I'd like to ask you to stand at this time in honor of all of these newly commissioned officers as this last oath is being administered. Thank you. Raise your right hand. I, Fred Cone.
I, Matthew Dale Trevino. Do solemnly swear.
To support and defend.
To support and defend.
The Constitution of the United States.
The Constitution of the United States.
Against all enemies.
Against all enemies.
Both foreign and domestic.
Both foreign and domestic.
That I take this obligation freely.
That I take this obligation freely.
Without any mental reservation.
Without any mental reservation.
Or purpose of evasion.
Or purpose of evasion.
That I will well and faithfully.
That I will well and faithfully.
Discharge the duties.
Discharge duties.
Of the office.
Of the office.
On which I am about to enter.
On the office of which I'm about to enter.
So help me God.
So help me God.
Ready? Two. At this time, Captain Brian Beck is presenting the new lieutenant with a Mameluke sword. The sword is a symbol of all of the arms that these lieutenants have sworn to bear in our defense and the defense of our great country. Captain Beck is a 1996 graduate of the Embry-Riddle Aeronautical University here in Prescott. He is a Harrier pilot and has just recently completed his second tour of duty in Iraq. Detail, left face. Forward, mark.
I think you'll agree that we're very lucky, very fortunate to have the young people who have just been up here. How about one more hand for them, please? It is now time to honor our outstanding graduates from our outstanding degree programs, and you might ask, what does it mean to be outstanding? The Greek philosopher Aristotle would suggest being happy through virtue. The Chinese philosopher Confucius would argue for being excellent through duty. The Indian philosopher Sankara would suggest being one with eternity. The French philosopher Foucault would suggest living on the edge with irony and a deconstruction of power. And of course, the American philosopher and jiveologist Duke Ellington suggested in 1931 that it don't mean a thing if it ain't got that swing. Do up, do up, do up, do up, do up. Our outstanding graduates have all of that and more. So Bruce Beckman, Kathleen O'Connor, Adrian Ackerson, Paul Barber, Matthew Polis, Alejandro Charis, David Martin, Trigvi Hulthuson, Kevin Jenkins, Justin Watkins, Andrew Zeliff, please come forward in an outstanding way.
Bob Fiegel, Chair of the Aeronautical Science Department, will now present the Outstanding Graduate Award for Aeronautical Science. This semester's recipient is Bruce Beckman from Milford, Connecticut. And graduates and outstanding graduates, let me have you come to the stage, other side of stage. Let's give them another round of applause. In addition, Professor Bob Fiegel will present the award for the Aeronautics Program. The outstanding recipient is Kathleen O'Connor from Terre Haute, Indiana. Dr. Mark Sensmeyer, Chair of the Aerospace Engineering Department, will now present the Outstanding Graduate Award for Aerospace Engineering. This semester's recipient is Adrian Ackerson from Prescott Valley, Arizona. Professor Mike Topper, Chair of the Aerospace Studies Department, will now present the Outstanding Graduate Award for Aerospace Studies. This semester's recipient is Mr. Paul Barber from Hollywood, California. And I'll correct that, Second Lieutenant Mr. Paul Barber. Dr. Mark Sinclair, Chair of the Applied Meteorology Department, will now present the Outstanding Graduate Award for Meteorology. This semester's recipient is Matthew Pallas from Mesa, Arizona. Dr. Robin Sabata, Chair of the Aviation Business Administration Department, will now present the Outstanding Graduate Award for Aviation Business Administration. This semester's recipient is Alejandro Chavez from El Paso, Texas. Professor Matt Jaffe, Chair of the Computer Science Department, will now present the Outstanding Graduate Award for Computer Science. Dr. Jaffe will present the recipient award is Andrew Nathan Davis Zaliff from Shingletown, California. Dr. Chuck Cohn, Chair of the Electrical Engineering and Computer Engineering Department, will now present the Outstanding Graduate Award for Computer Engineering and Electrical Engineering. The award recipient for both programs is Mr. David Martin from Oroville, California. Dr. Philip Jones, Chair of the Global Studies Department, will now present the Outstanding Graduate Award for Global Security and Intelligence Studies. This semester's recipient is Tryggvi Holtjesson from Westman, Iceland. Dr. Angela Beck, Chair of the Humanities and Communications Department, will now present the Outstanding Graduate Award for Humanities and Communications. This semester's recipient is Mr. Kevin Jenkins from Hillsboro, Oregon. Dr. Daryl Smith, Chair of the Physics Department, will now present the Outstanding Graduate Award for Space Physics. This semester's recipient is Adrian Ackerson from Prescott Valley, Arizona. And I believe that is the end of the Outstanding Graduate Awards. And now I'd like to bring back to the podium our Executive Vice President, Dr. Frank Ayers.
Well, I have the honor to announce the winner of the Ed King Award, a very special award for the Embry-Riddle family. This award was established by Ed King, a longtime supporter of Embry-Riddle, former member of our Board of Trustees. The purpose of the award is to honor a graduate who has made an outstanding contribution of time and talents to the local community and as well as the university and has a minimum of a 3.0 cumulative GPA. And those are minimum requirements for the individuals who were nominated and our winner. This year, the winner of the Ed King Award for fall 2009 is Rajaram Iyer. Rajaram, would you come up? Rajaram is an engineering graduate from Madras, India. Come on up. From Madras, India. And he goes by Ram, I think mainly because he probably got tired of us not doing well on his name. So he's a very gracious individual. Ram has actively involved himself in campus life and service to others throughout his time at Embry-Riddle. He served in the position of resident advisor in the Housing and Residence Life Department for 2 semesters. He was a peer tutor for over 3 years. Both of these positions on campus presented opportunities to assist his fellow students, enrich their experiences at Embry-Riddle, and help ensure their success. As a member of Sigma Gamma Tau National Honor Society, he spearheaded a UNICEF fundraiser, Change for Good, to raise contributions to help curb infant mortality in Africa and South Asia. His personal love for charities that benefit children also led him to assist with Books for Africa and First Book fundraisers conducted by the Mortarboard National Senior Honor Society. Ram served as president of the International Students Association and worked on the most successful international festival in campus history. He also assisted aerospace engineering professor James Helbling as a directed study student to establish an advanced CATIA course at the Prescott campus. He has achieved the Dean's List and multiple scholarships, Certificate of Commendations for his tutoring, and a Service Excellence Award. This is while he was going to school from the Housing Department. He graduates with a little better than that 3.0. He has a 3.939 cumulative GPA and a Bachelor of Science in Aerospace Engineering, which is probably not all that easy either. So with that, congratulations to our recipient of the Ed King Award, Ram. It is now my great pleasure to introduce a very good friend of mine and colleague, Dr. Tina Fredericks-Recasino. She's the university's vice president for research and also special assistant to the president of the university, Dr. John Johnson. Tina and I go back a little bit. We both hail from the faculty class of 2000, and we think the class of 2000 was a pretty good one, we suppose. So we've been with the university about a little over nine years now. And Dr. Recasino has a great commitment to this university, and she's come out from university headquarters in Daytona Beach to present the President's Award. So let's give a warm Embry-Riddle welcome for Tina Fredericks-Recasino.
Thank you very much. I'm very honored to be here representing Dr. John Johnson, our president. And I'm amazed at how cold it is out here compared to where I came from. But it certainly has put me in the holiday spirit and the spirit of this occasion. So thank you for welcoming me here. The highest student award presented to our graduates today is the President's Award. The purpose of this award is to honor an outstanding scholar and leader who has an exceptional record of academic achievement, has made significant contributions to campus leadership, and has a high level of extracurricular involvement and service in the community also, while maintaining a minimum of a 3.5 cumulative GPA. It's quite an achievement. In fact, Mr. David Robertson, our trustee who's here today, as we looked at the qualifications of these students receiving these awards, he and I said, my goodness, we were a bunch of slackers when we were in college. So you guys go. The winner of this year's President's Award for Fall 2009 is Adrian Robert Ackerson. He's receiving, come on up, Adrian. Adrian is receiving a dual degree in aerospace engineering and space physics, and he is from Prescott Valley, Arizona. Adrian achieved Dean's List for 8 consecutive semesters. That's pretty much all of them, folks. He was a member of Sigma Gamma Tau, the National Aerospace Engineering Honor Society, Sigma Pi Sigma, the National Physics Honor Society, the Ronald E. McNair Scholars Program, the National Scholars Honor Society, and Phi Theta Kappa International Honor Society. He also achieved numerous awards and scholarships for his academic achievements, including McNair Scholars Program Scholar of the Year, the American Institute of Aeronautics and Astronautics Robert L. Crippen Scholarship for Merit and Outstanding Achievement. He participated in research with a student team designing a hydrofoam phone array. You'll have to tell me what that is someday. To be used in, oh, now I get it. To be used in searching for sunken Roman artifacts in the Venice Lagoon of Italy. Wow. And a multi-particle collision model of a nuclear thermal rocket with the physics department chair, Dr. Daryl Smith. Quite impressive. Adrian lives by a model of leadership by example. He has 100% class attendance during his 4.5 years at Embry-Riddle. His homework assignments were completed and on time 100% of the time. He served as a team leader on several student projects. He also devoted time to community service and campus activities, such as the Experimental Aircraft Association and the Society of Physics Students. Adrian graduates with a 4.0 cumulative GPA and a dual major in both space physics and aerospace engineering with a minor in mathematics. Please help me congratulate Adrian on all his achievements. Congratulations. Do I have an award yet?
At this time, will the candidates for the degree, is Dr. Gary Northam here? Dr. Gary Northam, the chair of the Masters of Safety Science program, will come forward.
Will the candidates for the degree of Master of Science in Safety Science please come forward?
We are now looking to bring on
test. There we Carrie go. Tecundo Ajuya.
Carrie, his graduate research project was titled Safety Management Program for Wyndham Vacation Ownership and Wyndham Hotel Group. He is being hooded by Dr. Nancy Lawrence.
Christopher Lee Spiva.
Christopher's graduate research project was simulating the effects of human behavior during emergency evacuation. He is being hooded by Dr. Max Fogelman.
Walter Lowell Steem.
Walter's graduate research project was titled Medical Helicopter Operations, How Much is Safety Worth? He is being hooded by Dr. Bill Waldock. At this time, I would like to introduce Dr. Cass Howell, our Dean for the College of Aviation.
Professor Bob Fiegel, Department Chair of the Aeronautics Department, will now recognize candidates for the Bachelor of Science degree in Aeronautics. Will the candidates for the degree of Bachelor of Science in Aeronautics please come forward? Alex James Akins. Second Lieutenant Peter Anthony Arnold. Melina Margaret Burton. Christopher Stephen Tyler Chance. Bradley Joseph Falsetti. Michael Charles Gackey. James P. Holly. Graduating magna cum laude, Sun Ho Lee. Jeremy Michael Lutz. Jacqueline Nicole Maz. Graduating summa cum laude, Kathleen Elizabeth O'Connor. James Raymond Preston. David Michael Seagraves. Second Lieutenant Matthew Dale Trevino. Tom Yissel. Professor Bob Fiegel will now recognize candidates for the Bachelor of Science degree in Aeronautical Science. Will the candidates for the degree of Bachelor of Science in Aeronautical Science please come forward?
Graduating summa cum laude, Bruce William Beckman. Brandon Samuel Blair. Sarush Intazari. Jonathan Elliott Holt. Graduating cum laude, Bumju Kim. Graduating cum laude, Lloyd Peter Layton. Jesse Warren McDonald. Graduating magna cum laude, Kyle Joshua Nelson. Jeffrey Michael Pruitt. Jennifer Robinson. Also receiving a Bachelor of Science in Aviation Business Administration and graduating summa cum laude in both degrees, Noah Jerome Schultz. Nathan Tyler Veekman. Graduating summa cum laude, Daniel Zachary Weiss. Jonathan William Wilson. Miles Nicholas Yost.
Dr. Mark Sinclair, Chair of the Applied Meteorology Department, will recognize his candidates for the Bachelor of Science degree in Applied Meteorology. Will the candidate for the degree of Bachelor of Science in Applied Meteorology please come forward?
Graduating cum laude, Matthew Brian Paulus. Erica Lynn Sanschulte. Graduating cum laude, Eric M. Seastrom.
At this time, I would like to introduce Dr. Chuck Cohn, representing the College of Engineering.
Dr. Mark Sensmeyer, Chair of the Aerospace Engineering and Mechanical Engineering Department, will now recognize the candidates for the Bachelor of Science degree in Aerospace Engineering. Will the candidates for the degree of Bachelor of Science in Aerospace Engineering please come forward?
Darcy P. Bouchard, Jr. Second Lieutenant Afton Gene Brown. Julie Ann Clark. Chaz Cook. Graduating cum laude, Second Lieutenant Christopher Michael Deliman. Zane K. Fawson. Graduating summa cum laude, Second Lieutenant David Joseph Greco. Ethan Lloyd Grimsley. Graduating cum laude, Charles John Hatzel. Bryce James Hollenbeck. Graduating summa cum laude, Ram S. Ayer. Graduating summa cum laude, Kevin David Jenkins. Woo! Second Lieutenant Christopher Allen Corns. Jenna Marie Markham. Virat Mathur. Arpit S. Mehta. Carlin Ray Sidoris. Graduating cum laude, Christopher Suleiman. Sham Thoda. Ethan Douglas Tobias. Eddie Alberta Torres Zuniga. Jared Thomas Venn.
Now I have the honor to recognize graduates of the Bachelor of Science in Computer and Electrical Engineering. Will the candidate for the degree of Bachelor of Science in Electrical and Computer Engineering please come forward?
Wait for the rest of the group. Graduating cum laude in both degrees. David Gentry Martin IV.
At this time, I would like to introduce Dr. Archie Dickey, Dean for the College of Arts and Sciences.
I'll start with Mr. Professor Mike Topper, Program Chair for Aerospace Studies. We'll now recognize candidates for the Bachelor of Science in the degree of Aerospace Studies. Will the candidates please join us here at the podium?
Kanan Bahadir. Second Lieutenant Paul James Barber. Travis Timothy DeGroat. Jim Nigel Fernandez. William Thomas Hurst.
Dr. Robin Sabata, Chair of the Aviation Business Administration Department, will now recognize candidates for the Bachelor of Science degree in Aviation Business Administration. Will the candidates for the degree for Bachelor of Science in Aviation Business please come forward?
Graduating summa cum laude, Christine Elise Anthony. Also receiving a Bachelor of Science degree in Aeronautics, John Christopher Bulwer. Graduating magna cum laude, Alejandro Chavez. Mark Daniel Galvin. Graduating magna cum laude, Mary Elizabeth Cashew. Abel Albert Musangu. Graduating cum laude, Jessica Lynn Staley.
Dr. Philip Jones, Chair of the Global Studies Department, will now recognize the candidates for a Bachelor of Science degree in Global Security Intelligence Studies. Will the candidates for the degree of Bachelor of Science in Global Security Intelligence please come forward?
Ashley Roy Cheryl Branch. Lauren Marie Bromley. Joshua Lee Green. David Miles Hamilton. Graduating summa cum laude, Trigvi Schultesen Ice. Graduating cum laude, William Chandler James II. Second Lieutenant Christopher Joseph McNamee. Graduating cum laude, Matthew James Raffi. Graduating cum laude, Isabel Ruiz Theta. Bradley Taft Smith. Second Lieutenant Christopher Stephen Weinert. Angela Kuile Wu.
Dr. Matt Jaffe, Program Chair for Computer Science Program, will recognize his candidates for a Bachelor of Science degree in Computer Science. Will the candidates for the degree of Bachelor of Science in Computer Science please come forward?
John Charles Ackerman. Graduating magna cum laude, Second Lieutenant Andrew Nathan Davis Zeliff.
Professor Mike Topper, Program Chair for Interdisciplinary Studies Program, will now recognize candidates for the Bachelor of Science degree in Interdisciplinary Studies. Will the candidates for this degree please come forward?
Receiving her degree by her mentor, Professor John Jenkins, Sabrina Myrie Ricks. Second Lieutenant Andrew Roy Wren.
Dr. Daryl Smith, Chairman of the Physics Department, will now recognize his candidates for the Bachelor of Science degree in Space Physics. Will the candidates for the degree of Bachelor of Science in Space Physics please come forward?
Also receiving a Bachelor of Science in Aerospace Engineering and graduating summa cum laude in both degrees, Adrian Robert Ackerson. Matthew Ian Tarbutton.
Dr. Gary Witt, Director of Academics for Worldwide Sky Harbor Campus, will now present diplomas for candidates from our Worldwide Campus. Dr. Witt was one of the final seats here on the stage. Dr. Witt.
Will the candidates for degree of Master of Aeronautical Science please come forward?
Ryan V. Albrecht. Belinda Ann Burnett. Nancy Elizabeth Eberhardt. Kenneth Walter Engasser. Robert Todd Henderson. Being hooded by Professor Jamie Beatty and receiving her degree from her son and colleague here at Embry-Riddle, Robert Kelm, Laura Diane Kelm. John Philip Popovich.
Will the candidates for degree of Master of Science in Management please come forward? Will the candidates for a degree of Master of Science in Project Management please come forward? Nobody in that one either. Will the candidates for a degree of Master of Science in Technical Management please come forward? Will the candidates for a degree of Bachelor of Science in Aviation Maintenance please come forward?
Michael Dwayne Darling.
Will candidates for the degree of Bachelor of Science in Professional Aeronautics please come forward?
Brent Samuel Brown. Austin Richard Johnson. Graduating summa cum laude, David Randall Wilkerson.
Will candidates for the degree of Bachelor of Science in Technical Management please come forward?
Graduating graduating cum laude, Nicholas Burgess. Richard Donald Cordova.
We are very fortunate to have one of the trustees with us today. Mr. David Robertson, please come forward. And will all candidates for degrees please rise? Mr. Robertson, upon the recommendation of the faculty and the deans, it gives me great honor to present to you the candidates for Embry-Riddle degrees as noted in the introduction of each candidate.
That is a wonderful introduction for my reading the legal fine print here, which, okay, by the authority vested in me by the Board of Trustees of Embry-Riddle Aeronautical University, I hereby confer upon you, as appropriate, the Bachelor of Science, Master of Business, and Master of Science degrees, with all the rights, privileges, honors, and responsibilities pertaining hereunto. You may now move your tassels from the right to the left side of your mortarboard to signify that you have graduated. Folks, congratulations, folks.
At this point, I'd also let you all continue to stand, and I would like to bring Kui Wu and Ashley Branch forward to sing the alma mater. They are both Global Security Intelligence Studies graduates. Kui is from Malekio, Hawaii, and Ashley is from Baytown, Texas. The words to the alma mater are on the back of your program. We would encourage all of you to join in with them.
Please be seated. Graduates, how does that sound? Graduates. How about one more hand for our graduates? Ooh. I like it. Oh, I like it. That was good. Graduates, we want to take a minute, now that you're boasting with newfound pride, the tassel's on the left side, you've completed it. Let's take a moment to reflect on those times the last 4 or 5 years when times were a little tough, when you had some challenges, when you had to get through, and on the end of a phone or down the hall in an office or somewhere within the embryonal family, there was someone to talk to. I would like some special people to stand up who have made all this possible. First, I would like to have the parents of the graduates please stand to be recognized. Now, I would like the grandparents. Grandparents, do we have grandparents? Please stand. Aunts and uncles. Aunts and uncles. Other family members, spouses, children. And anyone who just came out today to support the graduates. Thank you all. Embry-Riddle parents, family, and supporters rock. We think you're very special. You're part of our family. I also have a group of people who I think, graduates, you might want to take a minute and thank, and I'm going to ask them to stand. I believe that Embry-Riddle, now I could be a bit biased in this, so you have to accept that, has the absolute finest faculty and staff of any university in the country. And I'd like our faculty and staff members to all stand and be recognized, please. Graduates, it's a big world out there, but you're well prepared. Go out, make us very, very proud of you. Please remember that we're a phone call or an email away, and please remember that we are always your Embry-Riddle family. Thank you very much.
Ladies and gentlemen, honored graduates of Embry-Riddle, actually honored new graduates of Embry-Riddle, we conclude our commencement exercise this morning with a benediction, with a retirement of the colors, and with a recessional led by the platform party, followed by faculty and the Embry-Riddle graduates of 2009. The Embry-Riddle faculty has requested the opportunity to congratulate each of you individually and to meet the graduates and family and friends. We will be doing this post the exercises over in the Eagle Gym right next to the Activity Center, which you are in now. So please join us there for pictures and introductions and congratulations. At this time, I would like to ask one of our new graduates from the Global Security and Intelligence Studies Program, Trygvi Hulchesson, or we do call him ICE, from Westman Islands, Iceland, will now deliver the benediction.
Father, now that we have transcended this path and begin a new journey, we ask you to grant us faith and courage. Thank you for the strength provided and the resolve needed to prevail. Keep us forever on the righteous path. We truly give thanks for the glorious experiences we've shared. And now, Lord, in the complex arena of human relations, help us to make choices on the side of love and not hate, on the side of inclusion and not exclusion, and tolerance and not intolerance. We know you will not leave us alone, and with your power and your heart of love. Help us then to work for a day when a man shall not lift up a sword against his brother, when none shall be afraid, when justice will roll down like waters, and righteousness as a mighty stream. Grant us the power and bravery needed to add purpose to our days and to begin our next journey into life. I would like to end by giving you a blessing. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Number 6. In the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, let all those who do justice and love mercy say amen.
Thank you, ICE. Audience, please stand. Color guard, please retire the colors.